Yeah, get it on. Got to get it on. No choice but to get it on. I want to welcome, finally, a woman to this podcast, the beautiful Jules Asner. Jules, great to see you.
Nice to see you, Adam.
Jules and I go way back. You probably go back with Jules as far as Wild On, which is a fantastic memory for most males.
A decade old.
Really?
10 years ago, yeah.
How did that start for you?
It started, well, there's different versions. The real version is that they had gotten a porn star to host this as a special, this show.
Mm-hmm.
It was called Sex On at the time at E. And she had gone to some opening of a Planet Hollywood and had sex with a big movie star, and it became quite a scandal. I think they had rough sex and messed up the hotel room. And the star's wife called Disney, who at the time owned part of E, and said,
Tony Randall's wife called Disney.
Yeah.
I'm just doing the math.
Right.
I know you can't mention any names. So.
And they wanted, so then they needed a new host, but they wanted to get somebody that they didn't think was trashy in a way or would have sex with people on the show. They wanted someone they felt was kind of clean cut. And so that's how I kind of got
it. And then where do you come from?
I was a news producer. I worked at the show Hard Copy for a long time, an extra, just behind the scenes.
Mm-hmm.
And I'd done some on-camera stuff, but not a lot. And then I came to E! As a producer. I was a reporter in the news department.
So this
News
is like
Daily.
This is like Knocked Up. I mean, in the sense that Katherine Heigl is like behind the scenes.
Yes.
And when you watch these movies, you go, oh, please, she's too good looking. They put her in front of the camera, but maybe not.
Right. No. Yes.
So Jules Asner's behind the scenes.
Yes.
And now they're getting rid of the porn star, and they're looking to replace them with someone who's a little more wholesome.
Right.
But easy on the eyes.
Right. So they ask me, they go, do you have a passport? Do you have a bikini?
Mm-hmm.
We need you to get on a plane. And that's kind of how it all started.
And you went everywhere.
I went everywhere. I went to 25 countries in a year and a half.
And I would always watch it, and sometimes you'd hit cold weather climates, and I'd be like, well, how are they going to get Jules into? And then it'd be like, hey, welcome to the hot tub. And I was like, yeah. And then so it was you, and then Brooke Burke took your place.
Right. Then it just became too much.
And the travel, whatever.
Yeah, it was too much. And I have to say, being E, they flew me coach to all those great places. So
sure.
I was all over the place,
right.
Really jet lagged, but it had done well, and they thought at the time that it was doing well in the ratings that I would go to news and anchor the news with Steve Kometko, and that would maybe help the ratings of news, and then they hired Brooke. Yeah,
right. Yeah. It's so. I mean, you could just hear the guys at E talking to the guys at Southwest going, "You don't fly to Rio de Janeiro at all? Nothing? Really? There's need of nothing from Burbank to Rio." I know. People have no idea. You know, people think, oh, celebrity. Oh, it's awesome. Not everywhere. And not all the time.
Well,
I mean,
especially not at E then.
Not at E then.
I remember flying to Thailand, and we were flying through Hawaii. And again, nobody feels bad for me when I tell some sort of bad,
Wild On story. I do, because shitty flying sucks.
Well, I flew to Hawaii and then was going to catch a flight to Australia, but nobody had realized at E, who'd booked it, that there was a 9-hour layover in Hawaii, and it was in the middle of the night. It was something perfectly from we landed at 10 p.m. or 11 p.m., and the flight didn't leave in the morning till 9.
Yeah.
And then they didn't want to pay for a hotel room. It's not like they would say, go to a hotel by the airport, so we just stayed. And it's outdoors in Hawaii. You probably know this.
Yes.
It's raining. It's outdoors. So we're
You're
on a bench.
Attacked by gecko.
Yeah.
I've said this many times. The people who make the flight arrangements or the travel arrangements in general should have to do the travel.
Yeah.
Because when they're divorced from it, you get some of the shittiest travel arrangements ever. When me and Jimmy Kimmel were over at K-Rock, we'd go to New York. They flew us Tower Air.
Right.
They didn't have a fucking terminal at LAX. They had a bus that took you to the plane. They had a 747 with every first class seat taken out. It was a gutted 747. It had 650 coach seats in it. The bathroom in the middle galley was destroyed halfway. It sat on the tarmac for 3 hours. This was all in the name of saving $30.
Right. I remember when I worked at Hard Copy and Jon Stewart did his show at MTV in New York. I mean, this is, you know, a long time ago, and they flew him out to do shows in L.A., and he was the host of the Jon Stewart show on MTV. They made him land twice. They wouldn't fly him directly from New York to L.A. He had to change planes twice, again, to save, I don't know, $100.
And when we used to do, when me and Drew used to do college tours, they always wanted to save and not get a driver or a car. And I shit you not, we'd get to the airport. We'd be doing, you know, we'd be to Indiana or Kentucky or whatever. We'd get to the airport, and a kid from the student union would pull up in a 79 Corolla hatchback with his roommate's hamper in the back. I shit you not. He had a hamper. I remember we're saying, like, where's your car? We have a week's worth of luggage because we're doing a college tour. He borrowed his roommate's car. It's a two-door with a hatchback in it. Drew and I are both 6'2", and his roommate has a hamper filled with dirty clothes in the back seat that Drew's trying to mash his 6'2 body into. Yes, this is what happens when you let somebody else make the travel arrangements. One of the greatest moments of my life, by the way, was when Drew and I were supposed to go to Chicago to do the Jenny, oh, what the hell was that crazy?
Jenny, I know who you're, she, Jenny Jones.
Jenny Jones. Jenny Jones. Thank you. We were going to Chicago to do Jenny Jones. Mm-hmm. And it was one of those, we'll fly out on the 7 a.m. flight out of LAX, first class, to do Jenny Jones. And we'd done Love Line the night before, so we were up till, I was up till 1:30, 2 in the morning, and I got up at 5, and I packed my shit, and I went to LAX, and we went to get on the plane, and I said, you ready to go? And they said, yep, you have one coach ticket to go to, and I said, coach? And they said, yep. And I said, they said they're flying me first class, and they said, nope, you got a coach ticket. And I said, tell Jenny I said hi. And I just turned around and started walking back. And I said, fuck it. I'm just, I don't want to go. I don't give a shit. They said first class. They got me a coach ticket. And I'm getting in a shuttle. And I'm going back home. And I'm going to bed. And I started to split. And they tackled me. And they got me a first class ticket.
But I have to say, as a guy, you can get away with that, where being a woman, or be, you know, being at a place where, like, we're giving you this chance, when you start making rumblings, then you get labeled as a bitch.
Yeah.
Jules is being difficult or bitchy.
Yeah, right.
Or I just never liked the bait and switch where they kind of told me it was going to be one thing, and then in the end, and I'm like, I have a good sense of humor. I can be on the joke. Don't make me feel like an idiot, because then that makes me.
So you go, now we'll go back further, and then we'll jump ahead. You grow up where?
I'm from Arizona. I'm from Tempe, Arizona.
And you grow up in Arizona, and you go to college where?
I didn't go to college.
No college.
University of life. Yeah.
So smart.
I went to a little bit of college, but I never graduated. I had to work. I mean, I had to have a job.
I love that about you. Authored a book called Whacked, by the way, at Amazon, now in paperback, if you will. So don't go to college. Go from high school to what?
Well, I was a model at a certain point. I have always been really tall, and I won a modeling competition when I was 16, so I was a model. I left home, and I modeled in Europe, but I was not successful. I was the world's least successful model.
Well, if you worked, you were successful,
though. But I barely worked. I mean, I would not work enough and then get one job to get me 3 weeks more of living, and then I wouldn't work. So
I don't know. You tell me how this works. You're very good looking, and I'm sure when you were 17 and living in France, you were very good looking as well. And I see Kate Moss, and I don't really get it. Like, I know she's good looking, and she has nice bones and everything, but why does she get $20,000 a day to model? And when I find out that, like, Kate Moss or Iman or whoever or whatever the big models are making, you know, such and such an amount, or $10 million a year, I don't really get it. Like, I'd look at a 17-year-old Kate Moss and a 17-year-old Jules Asner and be much more attracted to a 17-year-old Jules Asner and say, why don't you come walk down my runway?
Well, thank you. But I guess it drives sales. I mean, when you see...
When I say walk down my runway, I mean sex.
I know what you mean.
Yeah, okay. Sorry. I didn't know if that was clear.
No. We're in a garage.
Yeah. So...
No, but like Giselle Bundchen. When she wears a bra on Victoria's Secret, they'll sell you know, 800,000 units
because
that
it's her
bra. Yeah, well, yeah, she's developed. People look. You look at Giselle and you see how great she looks in that bra. You think, I want that. So I.
But
think
you would look that great in that bra as well. So why don't we just get you at 1/10 the cost of Giselle? I mean, I know how it works. Now Giselle's a brand,
right? Exactly.
But back before anyone was a brand, mm-hmm. and you're just a good-looking person standing next to another good-looking person, why not you walk down the runway? That's all I'm saying.
But I have to say, I look at those pictures from when I was 18, which was a long time ago, and I was funny looking. Like, I had crazy eyebrows, and it was a bad hair. I mean, remember 86,
yes.
87? It
yes.
wasn't a good looking...
Yeah.
When I look at that now, I'm like, how did I get a job?
Yeah, everybody looked like they're out of a Prince video.
Yeah, exactly.
Except for me. I never changed my look, but I always had Brillo hair, so I could never do anything
with
it.
You never had long in the back? You never let that go?
I am pleased to say... that and very proud to say, and Donnie, when we go into the next room, we'll show you video of me when I was 18, 19, and 20. And Donnie, please back me up here. I have never looked different than I look now, except for I'm old. But my hair, my hair is always the same. I never got into your shitty Flock of Seagull music or Men Without Hats.
I wasn't into those
guys. Had the same haircut I have now, and I listened to John Hyatt when I was 19.
He's
true
consistent.
Or false?
Consistent.
Okay.
Yeah, so I have none of those crazy things to look back on, and I never get to play that, oh, man, we're all dressing like we're in Flock of Seagulls, and we're all dressing like we're extras in Adam Sandler movies because it was the 80s. I had none of that.
Yeah. Didn't Leno pull out your yearbook photo or something?
Yes.
And it was fine? It was not embarrassing?
It's not like I was good looking or anything,
right.
But my hair, I have about the same choices with my hair that my Labrador Molly has with her mm-hmm. hair, which is no choice at all. It's just curly and it's just there. I wasn't so pompous or so stupid that I thought I could pull some sort of weird mullet off. And plus, I lived out here the whole time. So it's not like I was...
Right.
If I was from New Jersey, I'm sure I would have looked like Joey Buttafuoco.
Right.
But I was here, and I just never... and I was poor, so I could never go with the trends. Like, mm-hmm. hey, man, I got to get one of those members-only jackets. It's 80 bucks, but it's money well spent. I didn't have the 80 bucks.
Right. Do you use product in your hair, though?
I just got back from the Mexican barber lady 10 seconds ago, and she said, do you want me to put gel in your hair? And I said, no, I'm just putting a hat on. But no, I will, yes. Otherwise, I'll look like pube head.
Okay.
So my hair will be too dry. So, yeah, it's a little short now because I just got a cut, and I'll put some butcher's wax or something in there. Yeah, you don't want to see my pube head. So you start off in Arizona. You go to Europe.
Right.
You model.
Went back and finished high school in Arizona because mm-hmm. I was not a successful model. And then I moved here and was trying to find a job. I mean, I went to Valley College
yeah.
a little bit.
You were a monarch.
Yeah.
So was me in the weeds.
Just a little bit. It would get hot out there and they wouldn't air condition the rooms.
No.
No.
I think they kind of wanted to get you out. Like,
yeah.
it was the kind of thing you do like when... you know, like some guest comes in and spends a few too many weeks on your sofa
mm-hmm.
and they come in and they're like, hey, man, you're out of shampoo. And you're like, yeah, we are, aren't we? Yeah, maybe you should go somewhere and get some.
Yeah. They would try to sweat you out.
Yeah, you'd sit in one of those bungalows in July and you're like, it's just September and be like, this is pretty miserable.
Right. And it was kind of depressing, too. Going, I mean, being there, you felt like you knew you weren't the top. I mean, you knew where you fell.
You weren't the top of the middle.
No.
No, well, that's why I don't like it called community college. I always call it junior college because there needs to be a shaming involved. Otherwise, I don't like the euphemistic, you know, oh, it's community college.
Yeah, and also I won a writing award there, and I was kind of like, well, what does it mean to win a writing award from your English class? At
yeah.
Valley College. It was...
Eh.
But then I went to UCLA and I started...
Oh, you transferred.
Well, yeah, through the extension. I started taking some classes there, but then I got the job at Hard Copy and I was hoping to get a job in production. I'm working on TV or in the news.
So now we're into the early 90s and you're working on Hard Copy?
Yeah, I was working on Hard Copy when it was fun. It was a lot of fun.
And who was hosting at the time?
Terry Murphy
mm-hmm.
and Barry Nolan.
And then who went on to do that? They went through a few people over there,
maybe
right?
In the end they did. maybe in the end they changed it up, but I think Barry and Terry were really there for most of the time.
And you were segment producing and doing that kind of stuff?
I wasn't even
that.
I was a story coordinator. So I read, they would get all these local newspapers, and I would read the newspapers every day to try to find the crazy stories, you know?
Right.
People and, kidnapped or...
And by the way, you know, pre-internet, obviously, you're just getting the Long Beach Press Dispatch to see if there's something good in there. I mean, you're getting papers from Indiana.
No, it was the Kenosha, Wisconsin. Right. Yeah, Tribune, those kind of things.
And you're just combing through every newspaper.
And that's how it started. You know, five of us would just sit there with big, those mail things of the crappy papers and going through and cutting things out and trying to pitch them. But then I worked my way up. I became a segment producer, and then they let me be on air.
Right.
It was great. It was still the most fun I ever had. Like, I still, that feeling of being part of that.
And Wild On goes to, that eventually leads into Wild On, and that goes for about a year and a half, and then eventually you go, screw it, I want to get married, I want to settle down, I want to have some kids, I want to work from home.
No, I was still, I mean, I had a boyfriend, but it just, and it was hard on that too, because that was before really even cell phones. I mean, the way I was traveling, it wasn't like I had a phone on me. You had to, you know, it was expensive to call, and I would have missed my boyfriend so much.
Plus, you had a bunch of super creepy European guys coming on to you wearing banana hammocks all the time, right?
Yeah, it was a little, but also we did a lot of
Jules, why are you so uptight? But take your top off. This is how the women go on the beach here. Why are you uptight? You're an American who's uptight?
Well, it's perfect.
Take your top off. It is what we're all doing here.
It's perfect, too, because we did so many of them before they ever aired. So it was only towards the end where people became familiar with the show. So, of course, I leave and Brooke comes and Brooke gets, you know, the glory and because everybody knew the show and
it
was so much easier.
Well, it couldn't happen to a nicer person. It really couldn't. She's a delight. She's a delight.
Brooke's.
Thank you. Brooke. It was so funny because I don't know why I know Brooke Burke's a pain in the ass, but I just know she did Loveline once, and I was like, ugh, yeah. It's hard to ruin me on a woman that beautiful, but I was like, yeah. I couldn't stand talking to her after like 20 minutes. I want to kill myself. And when I did, I don't know. I did Dancing with the Stars, but I went back the next season to go do something. I went back to go do, they wanted me to come back and do something. Mm-hmm. So I went back to go do something, and it was like the first week. And there was, you know, 12 stars or whatever, 10 stars or whatever. They had a full boat. No one had been eliminated yet. And I walked into the makeup room, and I used to hang out with the hair ladies and the makeup ladies. And I was the only non-pain in the ass over there because I didn't really have any, oh, you're not doing it right, or here's what I require.
Right,
or I'm bringing in my own person. They liked me just because I didn't give a shit.
Mm-hmm.
And plus, on Tuesdays, on elimination night, I would go in there and drink with them before because I didn't have to dance.
Right,
you know,
so
I just
would
stand around and have a couple glasses of wine. Why not? So it was funny. I went in and I sat down and they're putting makeup on me. And I said, so how's the new crop of celebrities treating you? Because, you know, they'd have to deal with Priscilla Presley. You know, those poor makeup and hair people have to deal with all those nutty broads and nutty guys, too, by the way. And I would sit. So I said, who's the pain in the ass this year? Because there's always one pain in the ass, you know.
I honestly only watched it when you were on because I thought that was interesting. I thought that made it interesting for me.
Well, they wouldn't answer because they didn't want to get into trouble.
Oh, really?
They were like, we can't tell you who the pain. And I said, Brooke Burke? And they went, kind of. And I was like, huh, interesting that I was able to figure out the one pain in the ass celebrity out of the group. So we can all agree, no one's a fan of Brooke Burke. Now, you got out of there. So no more Wild On.
I didn't do Wild On. I hosted E! News.
Right.
And that was a lot of fun and all the premieres and all that stuff. And then I hosted a different interview show while I was doing all that called Revealed with Jules Asner at the same time. So.
And then Steven Soderbergh's your husband, right?
Yeah.
He's the famed director that I got in trouble for because I made fun of Ocean's 13. I want to say this about Ocean's 13 now thinking about it.
Mm-hmm.
Now thinking about it. It was a wonderfully directed film. It was a horrible script, but it was a very well-directed film. And I hope your husband didn't write it.
He didn't write it, but he works with the writers.
Oh, okay. All right. Yeah. But it was shot amazing. It looked amazing.
I think the idea when you see an Ocean's movie is, you know, you sit down, the music starts, it's beautiful. I think his intent is that you have a smile on your face throughout the film.
You
which
get
I'm
swept
sure
away.
You did before you walked out, but
I was angry.
I know.
But the direction was not bad. The writing was bad. The getting the second Chunnel digger and
one that, from the other side. That's still
buried.
Really bothers you.
Really
man.
Bothers me. But all right. But as obviously an acclaimed director has done many, many great films, and it must be kind of nice married to that guy, yeah?
Well, he's a nice guy.
He is.
He's a nice guy,
and
yeah.
He just did a movie with our good friend Joel McHale, which I hear is going to be very good.
It's really good. It's one of my favorite movies he's ever done. It's called The Informant with Matt Damon.
Give his top five movies just for people that don't know.
But I like... Well, now you're going to set me up. I like Ocean's 11 and Ocean's 12.
I like the Ocean's 11
really
and Ocean's
like
12, too.
I really like the Limey.
Oh, Limey was awesome. Who is that actor in the
Terrence
Limey?
Terrence Stamp.
He was good in that. Those of you who have not seen the Limey, and it kind of slid under the radar mm-hmm. just a little bit. Just a well-crafted sort of... I don't want to call it a low-budget film, but it was stripped down.
A little
like
lo-fi,
It was like unplugged. Mm-hmm. No pyro. The Limey was probably the exact opposite of the Ocean's trilogy.
Right.
Just
he
totally
wants to
stripped
do a sequel
down.
To the Limey, and Terrence wants to do it. Terrence and Michael Caine.
Where else is Terrence from? Where else do I
well,
see
he was in the Superman movies. He was a bad guy.
Oh, yeah.
But I think he was a big star in the 60s. But a film of Stevens I think you would really like that I really like that just came out is this movie GFE, The Girlfriend Experience, that stars porn star Sasha Grey. Just came out last month, and I think you'd like, it was really good. He shot it in New York on a low budget.
And is he doing, did I read right that he was going to do a Liberace bio?
Yeah, there's this guy who wrote a book called Behind the Candelabra, and he is Scott Thornton, but he was Liberace's gay lover.
Oh, we got to get into this.
And so they bought the book. Well, they wanted to buy the book, but when they called to buy it, they said he was in the witness protection program, Scott Thornton, and they couldn't find
Gay
him.
Gay mafia coming after him.
No, I guess he was a witness in the John Holmes murders or something.
My head is going to explode. Okay, couple of things.
Okay.
The John Holmes Wonderland thing was crazy because I grew up out here, and Donnie, for Christ's sake, lived 100 yards from Wonderland. I mean, you know, maybe 500 yards. But we had friends that lived all throughout those hills. And you have to kind of think of Boogie Nights here. But John Holmes basically became a junkie, and he ripped off some other club owner, junkie guy. And these guys came back and gave him a little payback. Just a brutal... They broke into the house at night, and they beat, like, five people to death.
Right, and I think this guy was there.
And John Holmes, by the way, somehow escaped death, but would not talk either because they would find him and kill him, but AIDS found him and killed him before he could talk. Liberace had a young boyfriend, and I don't know if it's the same guy, who got a bunch of plastic surgery.
That's the guy.
To look like Liberace. So you could butt-fuck yourself?
No, this is the story. And
what the?
He got him to get the plastic surgery to look like him when he was younger.
But how about he get plastic surgery to look like Dirk Benedict when he was younger, not Liberace? First off, Liberace, not that good-looking a guy. So why do you want to fuck a young, not-so-good-looking version of yourself? Why not look like a young Elvis rather than a young you? I mean, here's the whole thing.
Narcissism breeds that.
I am so glad you're here, Jules, because I've screamed about this on air a million times, which is there's certain things in our little Hollywood lexicon that everyone makes a big deal out of. You know, hey, David Hasselhoff was drunk and he was telling his daughter to get him a cheeseburger, or Alec Baldwin called his daughter a piggy, and we make a big deal over it. And then certain shit that just kind of slid under the radar. Liberace got his boyfriend tons of plastic surgery to look like him. the guy he was fucking, or maybe worse, was fucking him, looked like him when he was 20, when Liberace was 55.
Right.
How fucked up is that?
That is very fucked up, but, you know, Liberace never admitted he was gay, had a very close relationship with his mother, loved his mother.
If the ghost of you at 19 is fucking you, does that make you gay? Or does it just make it masturbating with your, like, own cock in your own ass? It's like a snake eating its own tail.
Well, I think it sounds like a lot of fun, and Matt Damon has agreed to play the Scott Thornton guy.
Wow.
And Michael Douglas is going to play Liberace.
Oh, it is about goddamn time. This is going to be great.
That's what I love about Matt Damon, too, because you forget, he's Jason Bourne.
Yes.
You know, he's Jason Bourne, but he will do this other stuff and really...
Well, he put on a bunch of weight, for instance, to do the informant role
he put on, I think, 30 or 40 pounds, and then he had to take it all off to go back and do the Green Zone. He had to get in super shape.
So this guy, Scott, are we able to unearth him?
They found him, and apparently, even though he's in the witness protection program, he did Larry King a few years ago.
Hold on one second. Hey, Donnie, whack on the goddamn window and tell stupid Jay to stop hitting shit with a mallet. The last words that I uttered when I left the warehouse was, do whatever you want, just do it quietly, and out comes the mallet. Everyone's a genius. All right, so... I'm so glad that Steven is making this movie, because I've been screaming about it for years and I could never understand why more people didn't make a bigger deal out
right.
of it. Liberace was a household name. He was Liberace. He had one name, like Madonna and Cher. I mean, mm-hmm. he was up there. He was one of the biggest stars in the world for 30 years. He was gay and had a guy have plastic surgery to look like him. He died of AIDS. Like, why was this movie made 10 years ago?
It would have been a great movie 10 years ago, but I think it will be good with Matt and Michael Douglas. I mean, you would go see that at the Arclight. You'd go and...
I would definitely go. I feel I feel like I need to be a consultant on this. I went to the Liberace Museum.
I've been there, too. For Wild
Hunt. You were there. You were paid. I went on my own. I'm the only straight guy. When I walked through the door, by the way, confetti fell down, and I was like, what, am I the 2,000th person to want? And they said, no, you're the only straight guy who's ever come into the Liberace Museum. And then I went on a shopping spree.
And the cars are pretty neat, his cars that he has in the museum.
I would label them as elegant and understated.
Yes.
Yeah, there's a piano car, he's bedazzled his car. How people didn't know this man was gay is really... That's the next movie Steven needs to make.
But not even that he was gay. I remember my mom speaking about him and kind of with reverence. Like, he was viewed as classy. He was viewed as this exotic, classy. He was coming to town to perform. Could we get tickets?
Never time to settle down, ladies. I always loved that. Perpetual bachelor. Yeah, because he's getting a guy to look like him and then...
Yeah.
Yes. So I'm excited. How does it work? Steven just, I'm sure he gets a bunch of scripts and goes through a bunch of projects and gets his pick of the litter for the most part?
Yeah, he kind of knows. He develops most of his own stuff. I mean, he kind of knows what he's doing the next four or five things in a row.
And then how about you? You write.
Right, right, yeah.
So do you want to write a screenplay?
No,
and then is it weird if
I
you write a screenplay and you try to get your husband to make it and then he doesn't want to make it?
I wouldn't do that because
Why not write a screenplay?
Because I don't get them. When I read them, I don't get them. When I read them, I don't see it. Like, I don't see what the director must see or the vision. Like, I have no...
Right, but you like writing novels.
I like writing novels, and I'm working on my next novel. And also, I would never do that with Steven. That would be just so ish, just so typical. People would always think, oh, your husband helped you out. And well, people always say that anyway, but...
Well, but wait a minute. But you were on TV long before you met him, right?
Yeah.
So, I mean, do you get that? Do you get that your husband helped you out stuff?
I think so. I mean... Not to my face, but I think that sometimes... Or people will say, why isn't your book a movie?
Uh-huh.
And I'll say, I don't know, I haven't sold it yet. And they're like, well, why isn't Steven? And I go, well, what's he going to do? I mean, he's not going to make it a movie It's not like he can pick up the phone and get a studio to buy it to make it a movie. I mean, maybe something will happen, but...
Yeah, the sort of nepotism thing, kind of overrated in the sense that people assume you can do shit for them because you're in show business, and even people that are pretty high up on the totem pole can't necessarily... Like, if your book is great and would make a great movie, then your husband could make a phone call, and maybe... It would be made into a movie, but if it's not good, wouldn't translate well into a movie, people wouldn't go, well, Steven called, so we have to do it. They'd go, fuck you.
Right. And also, but I don't want to do that. Like, I don't want his help. Like, I don't want to go to him, and I don't want to be that person. I'd rather do it on my
own. Is he out of town a lot?
He is. He travels a lot. But that's one of the great things about writing is I can go visit. But I don't, you know, I don't like to go longer than 10 days apart.
Really?
Yeah.
And you stay home? You have kids?
We don't have any kids, no.
You planning on kids?
No.
Why not?
I never really wanted them. You know, I think you should really want it.
Yeah.
You know, and also I was never around kids, and my parents weren't that great to me.
Yeah,
and
so you got ruined.
Yeah, and so I kind of feel...
Damaged goods. Yeah. Yeah, well, no, here's what happens. I'm going to help you.
Okay.
Let me give you a little therapy.
Okay.
Because I have twins now.
I know.
And I got to tell you, the nanny loves them so much. And, you know, I'm lukewarm on them when I see them. I'm going to give you a couple pieces of advice. Okay. I think this is going to help a lot. First, this kind of thing where people go, oh, you got to have kids because you're at this age and you're at this income and you're whatever. Mm-hmm. That's bullshit. I mean, you know, have kids if you want kids. Don't have kids if you don't want kids. You don't have to have kids just because all your friends are having kids or had kids. But... Your view of almost everything in life gets sort of shaped at a very young age by your parents. Mm-hmm. You kind of see through the eyes of your parents. And if your dad was a cop and you went to the policeman's ball, then you like cops.
Right.
And if you saw your dad get pulled over and got the shit kicked out of him by a bunch of cops, you know, if your dad's Rodney King, you probably don't like cops.
Right.
You know, so it's kind of... viewed through the prism of your parents. And I come from probably the same environment that you came from in a certain way that your parents probably viewed the kids as a pain in the ass. And they become like, so what it is, I don't know, did your parents do that thing where you go like, hey, mom, could you drive me here? And your mom be like, I don't want to drive you there.
Oh, no, my mom did even better than that. My mom would not do the pickup. Like, if one friend would drive us to the movie, her mom would drive us to the movie, and my mom was supposed to pick us up.
My mom would just not show up. And so your parents left you with the general impression that kids were a pain in the ass and kind of a drain.
Right.
Like, they wanted money. They wanted rides to the movie theater. They wanted you to buy clothes. They wanted you to buy them yearbooks and Letterman jackets and shit like that. It was all one big hassle.
I just think they were unhappy.
Yeah.
They were unhappy.
They're depressed.
And they didn't really look at us as... You know, now when people have kids, people have struggled with infertility. And now the view about having kids is people want them. They're like a gift. And you think... Our generation thinks we're going to right the wrongs. And we are. We're trying to be different.
You didn't feel like you brought joy to your parents.
No. Like, I never saw my parents kiss or hug once.
And furthermore, they didn't celebrate you.
No.
Like, they didn't go like, oh, my darling Jules, she's a model, this is awesome, and I'm going to, you know, take the clippings from the magazine and make a shrine out of it and hang it on the front wall so it's waiting for her when she comes back from Paris and any of that. So they didn't do any of that.
No.
So you got essentially what I got, which is pain in the ass, costs money, wants rides to the movie theater, and then you never celebrate the home runs or the magazine covers or any of that stuff. No. So you have all the bad and none of the good.
Right.
So you have what so in your eyes, kids are sort of a drain with no upside.
Well, you know what? No, it's more that I would want to... My sister did just the opposite that I did. Is she was a stay-at-home mom and has two kids and is great and is a great mom. I guess I was just scared, or am scared. I wouldn't want to be a shitty parent. I wouldn't want to be a lousy.
You can't be. You'll never be as shitty as your parents.
I know, but I mean, I feel like at this age, I should have wanted it. Like, Teresa would talk on the show. She really wanted to conceive. She felt that clock ticking. I never felt that.
And Stephen doesn't want.
Well, he has an 18-year-old daughter from a previous relationship.
So he's not pushing.
No.
See, here, okay.
I think he feels lucky because he has a great daughter, and she just graduated from high school. And
here's what's happening, Jules.
Okay.
Here's what's going on. I know everything, okay. So you should just listen. The guy is not going to lead you to water, and when it comes to the kids, the woman is. This is the woman's agenda,
right?
And especially a guy who already has an 18-year-old. He looks at it as bullet dodged. Mm-hmm. I'm with someone who doesn't really want any kids. And most guys get sort of dragged along reluctantly and then are overjoyed when they have their children. And kids, and many things in life, are this way. On paper, they make no sense at all.
Right.
It's like, oh, they cost a bunch of money. And they, you know, I was standing with my daughter yesterday, and she's three, and she just started pissing all over the floor. You know, she, two times yesterday, she pissed in daddy's new garage, and she's pissing all over my hardwood floor. And and I got to pay everybody, and you got to get this, and you got to take them there, and you got to, they're fucking screaming at you. And it's like, there's really, on paper, there's just nothing in it for you.
Right.
On the other hand, there's a lot of shit that just, it sounds like a bad idea, but it's fulfilling on some level. Mm-hmm. It doesn't make sense. It just is.
And you've seen the change it's made for you, the person you were before you had kids. And
I couldn't be happier. But yet, if you would have asked me 5 years ago, would you just skate through life with no kids? Mm-hmm. I would have said, yeah. If my wife didn't push the agenda, I would have skated through it. There's certain things, mostly men, need to be sort of pushed into. Mm-hmm. And then once you get pushed into it, you go, oh, yeah, of course, I wouldn't have traded it for anything.
Right.
You have a very volatile combination of crappy parents that soured you on kids and an older husband who already has a kid is not pushing any agenda. So no agenda and crappy parents and bad taste in your mouth equals, screw it, I'm not going to have kids. I would recommend that you do.
Well, my husband's not really older. He's just 5 years older than I am. But you know what, though? And don't think, because two of my best friends in the last year, year and a half have had kids. Mm-hmm. And everyone always says this to me. Like, you really should think about it. You might regret it in 3 years. And I'll say, I don't know what I'm going to think in 3 years.
Yeah.
But sometime, you know, when I go over to their house and the kid's screaming and doing the whole thing, I leave, and I'm so glad I'm leaving.
No, it is. It's a weird it's a weird thing, and it's an impulse, and you almost are wired like a guy in the sense that guys just want to go, I want to get out of here, man. I don't want to deal with the hassle, like hassle of marriage, mortgage, kids, nannies, insurance. Mm-hmm. Dental checkups, preschools, like it all feels like it's all like you got a backpack and someone keeps ramming something new into it that costs money and it's hurting your back and it's weighing more and more. And you just think, fuck it. I get to go home to an empty big house, read a book, have a glass of wine, and there's nothing to do. It's definitely easier. Mm-hmm. But at a certain point, why be born?
Right.
You know what I mean? Like everything in life, every movie that your husband makes is a struggle, a hassle, a setback, but then he has this. It's his baby. And when you write your book, it's long hours and midnight oil and treatments and editors that don't like what you're doing. But there's pain involved with everything that's worthwhile, whether it's climbing Mount Everest or crapping out a couple of kids. The kids falls under the same heading.
Mm-hmm.
And I know what it's like because I used to do that too. I would, you know, I'd talk to my friends. Hey, man, we're going out and having some. I can't find a sitter. I'm screwed. I got to stay home. And yeah, I'd go, oh, what a sucker.
Right.
But you can't go through your life dodging these bullets. So you think you're getting away with something, but ultimately you're not. And you'll be happy without kids, too. Don't get me wrong. You have a big house and a nice life and a good husband. And you'll not know it. But the knowledge that you avoided it might haunt you.
And I've thought about this. But, again, just because it comes up more recently, just because of, I said, my girlfriends. But I don't feel that way now.
Yeah,
I don't feel that way.
Well, listen, with
and I feel like it's you should feel that way.
You should. But one more, and again, I'm not trying to get sex off you, so I don't have an agenda. But I'm just saying, I never felt like, all right, I want kids. I was always like, really. But and I've really never felt 100% about anything, and I don't know that you ever really do. It's just you just do it, and then that's what life sort of becomes. Because you're not dying to have kids does not mean you're not going to make a great mom. You'll make a great mom. You're smart. Mm-hmm. You're seasoned. You've been around. Maybe you've had a little therapy. You've taken a look at your past. You've realized the mistakes your parents made, mm-hmm. and some that you've made, and you will not fuck your kids up nearly as much as we got fucked up by our parents. I do love damaged goods, though. God, mm-hmm. we would have made a great couple. But so you will make a great parent, and I feel like I want to hug you and tell you, I'm so sorry for what your parents did to you, but that doesn't mean you won't make a great parent.
Okay, but just, I don't feel really damaged, although I know what you mean. I am damaged.
Like, no, not damaged, not damaged, but in the sense that the job that your parents did on you made you not really want to have kids. And thus, you're not going to be a good mom because you don't really want to have kids.
Right.
I guess. Or,
okay.
Or, I guess that's what I meant. And maybe that was more insulting. No, damaged goods is not really the right way to say it. But I just mean,
because I'm really happy. That's the whole thing, is I'm really happy. And I don't sit at home and think what's missing from my life. But it's what goes back to what you just said. You didn't. You didn't.
No.
Yeah.
No. And like I said, if you and I had been together, we would just be sitting home in my big house right now, not having kids.
Right.
Yeah. I know. For the next 100 years. But the good news, all right, so I will say, and I'm not putting any pressure on you. Okay. I'm just saying you will be a better mom than you think,
mm-hmm.
and they will bring a lot of joy to your life, and you will be just as happy without them as well. And living in the town you're living in, at the tax bracket you're in, you can have kids anytime you want, even if you have to go out of the state and
go
buy them.
Get one
spun. So they're fine. Jules Asner, the name of the book is Whacked.
Yes.
It is out on Amazon as we speak. And give your husband a fat kiss from me. And until next time, this is Adam Carolla for my new best friend, Jules Asner. And, of course, my buddy the Wheeze saying, Mahalo. That's the runner.